evening and welcome once again to our legal clinic. Once again, we have our friend Arthur Bergeron, who is going to talk about trusts today, which seems to be a popular subject. And I'd like to welcome all of you and glad to see all of you return in new faces. So without any further ado, I'll turn it over to Arthur. Arthur, once again, thank you for coming.
Oh, and thank you, Joyce. Thank you.
Nice to see you again.
And thanks for your hospitality here. I was mentioning to Tom, our great videographer who's been doing these for years, I realized it's been 10 years now that I've been doing these. You know, really, I'm starting to kind of, I can tell that I'm kind of buying in now because the traffic's starting to bother me in the summer. I'm like, what are these people doing here? And I'm like, wait a minute, I'm the problem, I'm not the solution here. This is really a problem. So, thank you all for coming. I was telling Joyce, I got to do a couple boring ones so nobody will come. These last couple, they've been kind of overflowing. I was actually talking to a person at one senior center. I do these at I think, 7 or 8 senior centers. And I told her about this topic, and she said, no, that sounds really boring. I don't think anyone's going to come to this. I said, trust me. This is important. So thank you all for coming. For those of you who haven't been here before, my name is Arthur Bergeron. I'm an attorney at Myrick O'Connell. Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us, 40 in Worcester and 20 in Westboro. And because we're a multi-specialty firm, everybody does something different. And so fortunately, that means that I just get to do this because I really like this. I do elder law. Elder law, my median client age is 74. My typical client looks a lot like a lot of the folks that are in this room. And the goal is to really kind of help people figure out kind of what their options are in a whole lot of different ways. And the reason why I decided to do this presentation is that the most common way that conversation starts when I've got new clients coming in that I've never seen before and they sit down is that somebody will say, I think I need a trust. And I'll say, why is that? Well, because my neighbor has one and told me that I have to have a trust. Or my daughter called and said, you know, Ma, you really need a trust, right? And so, and they're not sure exactly what that means or why they want to do it. So the purpose of this presentation is to give you a sense of where a trust may be a solution to a problem. Trusts are just a vehicle. What I do is I try to solve problems. People come with problems. I say, here are some possible ways of figuring it out. A trust can be a way to solve a problem. Different problem, different kind of trust. And we're going to talk about a lot of those by talking about my old friends, Frank and Mary, and their kids, Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. You've seen them all before. And as I always tell people, if you get that joke, you're old enough to be my client. You've heard that joke too. I mean, 1,000 times. It's been 10 years of that same joke. I'm trying to look for new material if anyone has an idea. So these folks are, and you know, their goal is to live in their house until they die and to be buried in the backyard. So that's kind of who I'm talking about. So before I start talking about, and I'm going to give you some different situations that these folks could find themselves in, and depending on their situation, they may or may not need a trust and may or may not need a various kinds. But before we start, a couple of definitions. So there are revocable trusts and irrevocable trusts, or revocable trusts and irrevocable trusts. And if you look in the dictionary, both pronunciations work. There are lawyers constantly arguing about how to say that. They both work. But what does that mean? So a revocable trust, if I want to give you something, I have a couple of ways that I could do that. If I want to give you $1,000, I can hand you the money. And if you take it, then as long as you didn't steal that from me and my intention was to really give it to you, at that moment it becomes yours. That is a legally binding gift because there was donative intent on my part, a desire to give it, and there was delivery, I actually gave it, and there was receipt, somebody actually took it. Once I've done that and given you the $1,000, I can't get it back, right? If I say, oh, I changed my mind, I want it back, I can sue you and you can keep that money because there was those things. There was a genuine gift. So if, on the other hand, I decide that I don't really want to give you the money right now, the $100,000 that, you know, I think you could use, but for various reasons, I'm not sure that you could handle that right now. Because you're incompetent, or because I don't like your spouse and I think he's going to steal the money, or for any number of reasons. Another possible thing that I can do is I can give the money to somebody else and say, I want that somebody else to hold the money as the trustee, as the legal owner of the money, but not for the trustee's benefit, for the benefit of somebody else called a beneficiary. And that's what a trust is. A trust is a description of a relationship between two kinds of humans. They don't even have to be humans. Trustees, who are the legal owners of things, for the benefit of beneficiaries. Now, I can just give somebody else the money and say, take care of this for my friend, or I can actually write down in a document, a trust document, or a trust agreement between me and this trustee, the rules as to how that money is going to get handled. And that's typically called a trust agreement. But unless that trust agreement specifically says otherwise, at any time, I can tell the trustee, I want the money back, because I'm going to revoke that trust. And that is what a revocable or revocable trust is. It's a trust that where there are assets that have gone into the trust being held by the trustee, but at any time, I can get them back. I, the donor, the person who donated that money that went into the trust, right? If on the, one other thing. Now, in addition to that trust being revocable, chances are that in the language of the trust, where I say the trustee is going to hold the money for the benefit of this beneficiary or this other beneficiary, there are going to be some rules in that trust. Here are how the trustees get changed. Can I remove a trustee? Can somebody hold him responsible? And chances are there's going to be a provision there that says, if I want to, I can amend those rules. I can leave the money in there in that trust, but I can amend the rules. I can make it not only a revocable trust, one which I can get the money back from, but also an amendable trust. I can amend it at any time. If, on the other hand, I put money into a trust or give money to a trustee with a trust document that says right in it that it is irrevocable, then it's irrevocable, which means I can't get the money back. Now, you have all heard that term, irrevocable trust, specifically in one context, and that is, how do I protect my assets for nursing home protection purposes? Because you've all heard that as long as money goes into an irrevocable trust, it's safe. That is incorrect. In order for the money to be safe, if it's going into an irrevocable trust, it has to also contain some other things in it. The trust has to say that I can't be a beneficiary once I put the money in there, and that nobody can make me a beneficiary, and that I can't amend it, right, in a way that's going to make me a beneficiary. It has to be unamendable in a number of, it has to start off with certain terms, and it has to be unamendable in a lot of ways. It has to be irrevocable and unamendable. So that's revocable trust and irrevocable trust. One more difference. Testamentary trusts and inter vivos trusts. What is a testamentary trust? If you sign a will, that will is called your last will and testament. If you die intestate, that means you didn't have a will. If the will contains in it, within the will, a trust that says, instead of giving this money to my child, I'm going to put this money in trust. I'm going to say that so-and-so, his brother or his mother or whatever, is going to hold that money in trust for the benefit of that child, then that trust within the will is called a testamentary trust. Now, testamentary trusts are kind of by their nature always irrevocable, because at the time that they come into being, it's because you're dead. So you're not going to revoke it, right? Because you're dead, and now there's a will that's being executed and there's money that's being figured out, and so that becomes an irrevocable trust, right? Until you're dead, of course. You can always change the will, and therefore you can revoke that trust. If it's not a trust that is within a will, then it is called an inter vivos trust. If it's not a testamentary trust, in all cases, whether it's revocable or irrevocable, any of that stuff, it's an inter vivos trust. Inter vivos meaning between people, between living people. Okay. So with that brief set of definitions, and you're going to hear those terms a lot as we kind of go through here, but I just wanted you to start off with that knowledge. So there's Frank and Mary, and there are their goals. But their goals, and by the way, so there's their basic goal. They want to live in their house until they die. They want to be buried in the backyard. They have a very simple basic estate plan. When one of them dies, they want to leave everything to the other one. When the two of them are dead, they want to liquidate the remainder. Liquidate means turn it into money. Liquidate the remainder and divide it among the kids. That sound like a familiar plan? That's not an uncommon plan. Now, that's their estate plan part one, though. implicit, though, in that plan is that there are certain people that they don't want to leave money to. The Department of Revenue, the IRS, the nursing home, the lawyers, MassHealth. They don't want to leave money there. So I often tell people, really, what I'm doing when I'm helping people plan is, first of all, make sure that the people who you want to get the money, and secondly, to make sure that it doesn't leak out to any of these other people that kind of by mistake are going to get money because you didn't plan to get rid of them, okay? So that's kind of what we're talking about in terms of these plans. So now we're going to talk about my friends Frank and Mary. You've seen this before. What do they own? They own a house that's worth $300,000. Frank has an IRA worth $150,000. Mary's the beneficiary. Frank has an annuity that is also worth $100,000. Mary is the beneficiary. So to me, it's one of life's great ironies that if you buy an annuity and the annuity is going to pay you money, you're not the beneficiary. You're the annuitant. I don't know why they call them that. The beneficiary is the person who gets the money after you die, right? And then finally, they have joint savings, $250,000. So their total assets are $800,000, and they are age 65. They're age 65. So they want to make sure that, as I say, that when one dies, the other one gets it all, and then after that, it gets divided among the kids. Now, when they're age 65, they are not as concerned as some of my older clients are about protecting this money for nursing home purposes. And why is that? Because at 65, your chances of getting Alzheimer's, which is the major cause of dementia, and dementia is the major reason why people go into nursing homes, because they don't need all kinds of medical treatment and equipment and all that other jazz. They just need someone to watch them and help them dress and help them eat and help them do some other stuff and make sure they don't walk out onto the highway. So at age 65, your chances of having or getting Alzheimer's are 1 in 9. By the time you're 85, they're 1 in 3. Why? Because during those 20 years, if you probably died, right? So if you're 85, it's because cancer didn't kill you yet, or diabetes, or heart attack, and all this stuff. So the older you get, I mean, the Alzheimer's and several of the diseases that cause dementia, but especially Alzheimer's, are really one of those diseases that kind of lingers. It's the thing that kind of is left if something else hasn't killed you, right? So right now, we're talking about Frank and Mary, and they're not worried about nursing home care. So we're not talking about that issue. They may be worried about estate taxation, because remember, one of their goals is to make sure the Department of Revenue doesn't grab any of their money. But because their estate is worth less than $1 million, remember it's worth $800,000, they're not especially concerned about that now. Okay? And so what is left in terms of the major ways that they can try to save money and time, not necessarily for themselves, for their kids, is avoiding probate. They want to avoid probate. Why do they want to avoid probate? And by the way, once again, there are their assets. So the purpose of probate is to make sure that somebody figures out who gets the things that you own when you die, specifically the things that are just in your name. That's the point of probate, okay? So if these are Frank and Mary's assets, how many people think that if, I'm trying to remember if my next slide is there, no, I'll keep going to the next one. And there are two reasons, and why do you want to avoid probate? So probate, and what the probate process, how that works, is that when you die, somebody has to go to the probate court. There's a probate court, right in Edgartown, Dukes County. It's got two people work there, right? It's a big office. And the purpose of the probate of the system is to figure out a couple of things. One, who gets the property after you die? So if you die and you own something like your house just in your name, or a bank account just in your name, or your car. The most common reason why people go into probate by mistake, basically, is they die owning a car. And it's got a title. And so the registry wants to know who owns it now. And to figure that out, a lot of times you have to go to probate. So somebody has to go to the probate court and file this document called a petition of probate and ask that the probate court figure this out. And the thing about once a year has passed, and I'll talk about that in a second, the probate court will authorize the distribution of those assets. And the way the court figures that out is if you have a will, then you distribute it according to what the will says. And if you don't have a will, the government has written a will for you. It's called the rules of intestacy, the rules if you don't have a will. And those rules are pretty straightforward. The rules say that If you die, and this is assuming no divorces and kids from different marriages and stuff, but if you die and you have a spouse and some kids, your spouse gets all the assets. And if you die and your spouse is dead, your kids get all the assets. So remember Frank and Mary's estate plan, which was they want to make sure if one dies, the other one gets all the assets, and if the two of them die, the kids get all the assets? Mm-hmm. Well, actually, they don't need a will to do that, right? Because those are the rules that are going to get applied anyway. I just kind of want to mention that to you. People will often say to me, oh, I have a will, and I did it so I could avoid the probate process. Well, no. The probate process happens if you die owning something individually, right? At the end of the process, the way things get divided up get determined by whether you have a will or you don't have a will. So whether you have a will or not, it's not going to eliminate the probate process, right? So what if, and the reason, one of the reasons why you want to eliminate that process is this other item, that the probate process takes at least a year. Now, why is that? It's because your lawyer is lazy. No, it's not because your lawyer is lazy. It's because if you die, all of your creditors have 1 year from the date of your death to file a claim against your estate in order to get paid. Because I told you one of the goals of probate is to make sure that the right people get the assets. But a big reason for probate is to make sure that the creditors get paid, that nobody else gets anything until your creditors have been paid. So by the way, that 1 year, which sounds long, is actually a short statute of limitations. A statute of limitations is the period during which you can sue somebody that you think owes you some money. So for example, if I were to get into a car accident with you today and run over you today, you would have 3 years from today to sue me. Otherwise, you would no longer be able to sue me for any damages or anything. If, on the other hand, I hit you with that car, but then I hit a stone wall and died, you would have 1 year from today in order to sue my estate. So from your perspective, that's a short statute of limitations. We've just reduced the amount of time that you have to sue me by 2 years. Of course, from the perspective of all of the kids, of my kids, or of your kids, or of my kids, that's a long statute of limitations. Because they've all got to wait for a year to see if he shows up or anybody else to sue me before anything can get distributed to the kids. So the two reasons why you want to avoid probate, one is to get rid of that year. And two is to avoid the cost. Because the hassle of filling in the forms and going to the probate court and seeing if you got it right and going through this whole exercise during this year is just a big hassle, which a lot of people don't want to try to put up with. And so they typically hire a lawyer, and especially if there's real estate involved, because then you might need a special permission from the court to sell a house if you're within that year or whatever. That typically is going to cost you about $5,000 or $10,000. So there are two reasons to avoid probate. You're going to save time, and you're going to save some money. So the question is, going back to those assets, so those are the assets, remember? They own the house jointly. Frank has an IRA. Mary has an annuity. They have a savings account. There's the total assets. So if Frank dies in this situation, how many people think that Frank's estate needs to be probated? Could you raise your hand? How many people think Frank's estate does not need to be probated? Could you raise your hand? Some of you people have been here before. Yes, you're right, right? And the reason is because the house is owned jointly. Frank and Mary own the house jointly. Legally, what that means when you own something jointly is that each of you owns 100% of that asset, subject only to the fact that the other person also owns 100% of the asset. I know that sounds like a weird legal concept. It's not owned 50-50. So when one person dies, that person's interest evaporates, leaving the other person as the sole owner. So regarding the house and the savings account, when Frank dies, Mary simply becomes the owner. Regarding Frank's IRA, well, Frank doesn't really own that asset. He thinks he does because he gets these bank statements. But it says kind of at the top, custodian for. He gets statements from people like Fidelity or the bank or whatever who are actually the owners of that money, but they're holding it for Frank. And they have to distribute it to him if he asks for it and stuff. But technically, they own it. So it doesn't go through probate as long as Frank has filed the death beneficiary form with them saying who gets the assets. You don't want to forget that death beneficiary form, especially if somebody has died. I've had that situation. Somebody's spouse died. They got a divorce. Two people got a divorce. And so the wife eliminated the death, the husband as the death beneficiary. He didn't want to go to that jerk. But the point is, she didn't name anybody else. She just got rid of him. And then she died on the train. She worked at State Street Bank. She died on the train to Boston, leaving a $900,000 IRA. There was no will. The rules of intestacy applied. They didn't have any children. So everything went to her 90-year-old father, who, by the way, was in a nursing home. So all of a sudden, the nursing home hit the jackpot. The guy was good for like 20 years in the nursing home with his $900,000. So you want to be careful about that. So Frank's annuity, typically annuities, you can also name a death beneficiary. And so in this case, Mary was the beneficiary. So upon Frank's death, there was no need for probate. What about Mary? What about when Mary dies? There are her assets. Raise your hand if you think we need a probate in this case. Raise your hand. Raise your hand if you think we don't need a probate in this case. It's pretty evenly split. And the answer is, yes, you do. Because there are two assets here that are only owned by Mary. There's the house, and there's the savings account. Most common reason why people will deal with a trust in this case is to try to keep the house from having to go through probate, because in this situation, Mary's the sole owner of the house. One of the things I just want to mention, therefore, is that oftentimes these kinds of dealing with this issue often happens when there's a single person, as opposed to when there's a married couple, because typically in married couple cases, one died, the other one simply owns everything. So Mary's motives to avoid, or Mary's probate avoidance alternatives. She could name death beneficiaries, like in the case of the IRA and in the annuity. She could change the annuity to name a new death beneficiary. It is possible that in her bank, she can go to the bank and name the kids as death beneficiaries. It has been my experience, banks vary on this. Banks will allow you to create a trust account there without a written document. They're called Totten Trusts. In which you can name a death beneficiary. Some banks will allow you to name multiple kids. Most banks won't. They'll only allow you to name one. So that's a possibility, though. She could own the property jointly with her kids. She could put the house and the bank accounts in joint names with her kids, thereby assuring that when she dies, her interest evaporates, and the kids become the sole owners of the property. Now, of course, there may be some problems with that, because, as I've said, in the case of joint ownership, everybody in the account owns 100% of the account. So any one of the kids, of course, can then go to the bank and take all the money out, right? Or any creditor of one of the kids can go and attach that bank account because it's owned 100% by that kid, right? So there may be reasons why you don't want to do that, right? And if you do it with the house, the problem is then if Mary wants to sell the house or mortgage it, of course, everybody's got to sign because they're all on the deed, right? So, but that's a possibility. Or there's the life estate possibility. Many of you have heard of that option. Oh, I'm going to transfer my property to my kids or to a trust and keep a life estate in the property. What does that mean? It means I'm keeping total ownership in the property until I die, the life estate, but I'm giving the remainder to somebody else. That is the property that ownership that starts at the moment that I die, when my life estate evaporates, right? Once again, because my life estate simply evaporates, leaving the other people, called the remainder men, as the owners, there's no need for probate in that case. So that's very handy, and that is, especially regarding houses, this is the least expensive way of dealing with the house. A lot of people, consider doing this. I will give you two problems, though, with this. One, both of them from the Vineyard, actually. One was a woman from Tisbury, if I recall, who called me and said, "Oh, Mr. Bergeron, I just wanted to talk to you. I've got this issue a number of years ago. I got one son, and I transferred this remainder interest to my son. I kept the life estate. It's been more than 5 years. I know my house is safe. If I need to go to a nursing home, except my son just got served with divorce papers by his wife, and I want to know if this is a problem." I said, "Oh, yeah, that's a problem. Because your son owns the remainder interest in the house, and at this woman's age, the remainder interest was worth about 80% of the value of the $800,000 house. And the life estate was worth the rest." So now in play in that divorce is 80% of $800,000, is that remainder interest. A second case, family from Oak Bluffs, lived in Boston, and many, many years ago, bought a house, lived in either Roxbury or Dorchester, Afro-American family many years ago, bought a house in Oak Bluffs, wonderful, wonderful house, 3 blocks from the water, lovely place, and that's where they retired to. And a number of years ago, they transferred a remainder interest to their 4 children, kept a life estate in the property. think it was four children or three. I think it's four. So now they're, you know, it's 20 years later. They're older. They're in their 80s. They want to move back to Boston and to Roxbury and to Dorchester. That's where most of their grandchildren are. They don't have a lot of cash. They've got a good, reasonable income, but not a lot of cash. But they want to sell the house. So they told their kids, because they wanted their kids to deed the property back to them so that they could sell the property. And three out of the four would do it. But one wouldn't. And so they said, so what can we do? Answer, nothing. There's nothing you can do. You can't force the kids to give you back your interest in the property. And they said, well, what if we sue him? Doesn't make any difference. He owns the interest. He owns the interest. Right? So, what can we do? Well, you could go to court and get a petition to partition the real estate, a petition to the land, to the court, to force a sale of the property and divide up the money. But you don't get the money. You only get the life estate part, which in this case would be about 20% of the money, and the kids get the rest. They said, well, what about a reverse mortgage? You know, can we pull some of our equity out through a reverse mortgage? I said, sure, as long as all the kids will sign the mortgage. They all have to sign, right? So there are some problems with using the life estate. So in some of those situations is where folks consider a trust. So the question is, so what Mary could do if she was concerned about these other things but wanted to avoid probate is she could create a revocable and amendable trust. Revocable in that at any time she could take the property back. Amendable in that at any time she could change the rules. She put into the trust document that the fact that when she died, she wanted the kids to divide up the property. She would also name one of the kids or more. She could name them all. Make sure if you're doing this that you avoid ties. You don't want to ever have a tie among trustees. And she would name one of her kids. And then she would say that upon her death, the property would be sold, liquidated, and the proceeds distributed. So if she does that, then as long as she's alive, the trust is revocable and amendable. Upon her death, the trust becomes irrevocable because she's dead, of course, so she can't take it back. But it would also become unamendable. She would say the kids or the trustee couldn't further amend the trust in order to grab a bigger share or whatever. So upon her death, the property would then get sold. So by doing this, she is assuring that she has total control while she's alive. And she's avoided probate. See how this works? So back to Frank and Mary, and they've got, oh, look, their assets grew. Now the house is worth $400,000. They've got savings of $550,000. They've got total assets of $1,200,000. And remember, that's over that magic number, the $1 million estate tax number. Now, in that situation, remember, things are joint and stuff. So when Frank dies, he's going to leave everything to Mary. And there's a 100% marital deduction in the estate tax system. So there's going to be no tax in that case. However, remember, those are the assets. So if Mary dies with $1.2 million in assets, there's going to be an estate tax. And the estate tax on that estate, a taxable estate of $1.2 million, is $49,040. And I won't explain to you how you compute this. That's just what it is. So you figure, remember, the tax if the estate had been $1 million would have been zero, right? Because it's exempt. So basically, she's paying about $50,000 just on that top $200,000 for a very high effective marginal rate. The tax rate on the first dollar over $1 million is 40%. And it stays 40% until you get to about $1,120,000, around there. So the question is there a way to avoid this? Well, once again, remember, the reason why this is happening is that they've got those assets. Frank dies, gives everything to Mary, and then Mary dies and the estate is too big. So what effectively has happened in that case is when Frank died, he threw away his ability to give up to $1 million tax-free to anybody he wanted except Mary. If he gives it to Mary, it's unlimited, right? But maybe there's a way that he can make sure that he gives away some of his money ahead of time so that Mary's estate is below $1 million. Now, of course, the easiest way to do that would be he could just give some of the money to his kids. But they don't want to do that, right? Because Frank wants to make sure that Mary gets all his assets when he dies, because $1.2 million, you know, with inflation, it isn't as much as it used to be, right? So the way that you typically deal with this, and many of you have heard of this, right, in various forms, they're called A-B trusts or family shelter, or credit shelter trust or family trust, is you, and I'll call it for want of a better term, an estate tax avoidance trust, because that's the point, right? Is that Frank could put up to $1 million into a trust for the benefit of, and he could name as his beneficiaries, both Mary and all of his kids, or anybody else if he wanted. It didn't make any difference, right? He could say that there are no early distributions required to any of the kids. The money has to stay there and only be really for Mary until Mary dies. And he can name Mary as the trustee. So how good is that? He creates a trust. He names his wife as the trustee. She's one of the beneficiaries, so she can get to the money anytime because she can distribute to herself, right? So as a practical matter, he's given everything to her. But because the money is in this magic trust, for tax purposes, gets taxed as part of his estate. And when Mary dies, does not get included in her estate, right? So once again, those are the assets. Frank dies. Say the house, remember the house is worth $400,000. Say Frank says, so I'm going to say right in my documents, whether they are trust documents or it's in my will through a testamentary trust, that upon my death, my house is going to go into this trust. Mary's going to be the trustee, right? It's for the benefit of Mary and all the other kids, but Mary has no responsibility to sell the house and divide up anything. So as a practical matter, Mary still has the house, right? But for tax purposes, when Frank dies, Frank ends up with a taxable estate. He didn't give everything to Mary, so there was a taxable estate. How much is it worth? $400,000, the value of the house. Because it's less than $1 million, he pays no tax. Mary is left with the rest. In just her name, $800,000. Say she dies the next year. Her estate's worth less than $1 million, so she pays no tax. So through the miracle of legal maneuvering, they have avoided the estate tax, right? So when you hear about people who are creating trusts for the purpose of tax minimization, estate tax minimization, and you can do this and basically eliminate the estate tax as long as the total estate is worth less than $2 million because you can put up to $1 million into this account, thereby leaving the other spouse with the other million, so you can effectively shield $2 million of estate from taxation. And even if your estate is more than that, you can still substantially reduce your estate tax because you can get that $2 million eliminated, so the amount that's taxable becomes very small. So that's why, in this case, Frank and Mary may want to create, to either put these kinds of provisions in their wills, in which case, when one of them dies, the trust involved is going to be a testamentary trust, irrevocable because Frank's going to be dead, and unamendable because you can't amend a will, or they could actually create separate, if they wanted to also avoid probate and make sure they weren't having to go through the probate system, they could create separate trusts at the while they're alive. Many of you have probably heard or seen those, where you create trusts while you're alive, where each person has a trust, each trust has some assets in it, and the goal of this is to make sure that when the first person dies, the second person's assets are worth less than $1 million, okay? So that's a place in which a trust may be warranted, right? Doesn't save you a huge amount of money, saves you $50,000, though not nothing, right? So, and by the way, same thing goes in reverse, right? If we've done all of these things, suppose that, you know, what they agreed when they did the trust, Frank was going to have the house just in his name and it was going to go into trust for Mary's benefit. And say Mary said, remember there was $550,000 in cash? Maybe she said all of the cash was going to be in her name. The other things couldn't be given to her because remember Frank had it's Frank's IRA and it was Frank's annuity. But suppose she says, I'm going to keep the cash in my name. When I die, all the money is going to go into a trust. Frank's going to be the trustee. It's going to be $550,000, and therefore there's going to be a taxable estate of $550,000. Less than $1 million, no estate tax. When Frank dies, everything else is going to be in his estate. It's going to be the house, the annuity, the IRA, all worth a total of $650,000. Less than $1 million, no tax. Okay? So that's estate tax avoidance, and that's why you'd use trust for that. But now we get a different situation. Frank and Mary are now 85 years old. They're back with their $800,000, but now, they're worried about nursing homes. So they're trying to figure out if there's something that they can do. So before I kind of go through what they should be doing, for those of you who haven't been here before, and I see a few people who haven't, we're going to go MassHealth 101. Here's MassHealth 101. Matt, the reason why you need to know this is because if you are in a nursing home and you're older, like a lot of us are, so you're on Medicare, or even have the state health insurance or any health insurance plan, the Medicare will only pay for up to 100 days in a nursing home. And they'll only pay that if you're there after you've spent 3 days admitted to a hospital. Because the point of the Medicare benefit and of Medicare in general is it's health insurance. So it's meant to pay the cost of getting better when you're sick. It doesn't pay the cost of staying the same. So after 100 days in that nursing home, no matter how sick you still are, you're off Medicare and on private pay. Now, private pay here at Windermere, I think, is still about $14,000, it may have gone up. So it's pricey, $14,000 a month. So for a lot of folks like Mary, they're pretty nervous about that. So, so Mary is interested then, therefore, in qualifying for MassHealth. And the reason for that is that once she has qualified for MassHealth, which is the Massachusetts name for Medicaid as opposed to Medicare, Medicaid is insurance for the poor. Medicare is insurance for the old. So once she has qualified for MassHealth, from then on in, she'll have to pay her income to the nursing home, probably a Social Security check, maybe $1,000. All the rest will be paid by MassHealth. So she really wants to qualify for MassHealth. She can do that as soon as she has less than $2,000 in countable assets. The house isn't countable unless it has an equity of less than $828,000. So she could qualify for MassHealth, but remember, in this case, she's got a boatload of cash, well, not a boatload, half a boatload. She's got $550,000 in cash, right? She's got a lot of money to spend down. And they would also count in this case. So she'd need to spend down that money. So, but what she has going for her is she has Frank. Frank is still alive. So if one spouse is in a nursing home and the other one's at home, while the spouse in the nursing home can't have more than $2,000, the spouse at home can own the house as long as it has an equity of less than $828,000. And by the way, if you've got a house, because it's Martha's Vineyard, I got to say, well, except some places are more than this. So if you have equity of more than, if you have a house worth more than that, then the typical device to deal with that is you have clients get a mortgage, right? Typically a reverse mortgage, so there's no payments, to pull some of the equity out so that you can end up with a house that's got equity, because the key is not how much is the house worth, what's the equity? You have to have equity of less than $828,000. So he can have the house, and in this case, it's below, right? It's only worth $400,000. He can have cash or cash equivalent assets, things that you can turn into cash, like everything he's got, his IRA, the annuity, everything he's got, up to $119,220, and he can have infinite income, and that's the key, that he can convert his cash assets into an income stream and thereby get Mary qualified. By the way, one other thing that I always need to mention at this point. In qualifying for MassHealth, everybody has in their head this 5-year look back order that you can't transfer assets, within 5 years of the date you're qualifying. That's not the case for transfers between spouses. So Mary can transfer her assets to Frank today, and as long as Frank's assets are right, Mary can qualify for MassHealth tomorrow. Okay? So Mary's going to transfer all of her assets to Frank. Frank is then going to take all the assets that are above that magic number, $119,220, and buy an annuity, a specific kind of annuity. It has to be an annuity that he can't surrender and get the money back. If it's that, then it's a cash equivalent asset and would put him over asset. It has to be an income stream only. But as long as he's buying an annuity that calls for equal monthly payments over a term that is shorter than his actuarial life expectancy, and his life expectancy at age 85 is 5.84 years. Doesn't make any difference if he just had a stroke and he's going to die tomorrow. His life expectancy is 5.84 years. It's all in a big chart that MassHealth has, and that's the number, okay? As long as he buys that annuity in any amount, so he can take all the rest of his money above the $119,000 and buy an annuity, calling for equal monthly payments to him. And then following his death, he can name anybody he wants. He can name his kids, he can name his lawyer. Never has happened, right? But he could. You know, I keep waiting for that day. And the day after he buys the annuity, Mary can qualify for MassHealth. Okay? So as long as Frank and Mary are both alive, they're okay. Somebody can qualify for MassHealth right away. The problem, though, is if Frank dies. If Frank dies using their current estate plan, which was when Frank dies, remember, everything he wants to go to Mary. Which means now Mary in the nursing home has got a problem. She's got all these assets. So she's going to have to spend down all the money. She's going to have to cash out what has turned into her IRA and her annuity. She's going to be, and then she's going to, I made a mistake. No, that's right. That home is still worth $300,000. And then she's still going to have the house. The house is not a countable asset. So MassHealth will qualify Mary as soon as she's spent down all the other $500,000. But they will put a lien on the house at that point to make sure that they get paid back after Mary's death. Not what they're really looking for in life. So the question is there a way around this for Frank and Mary? And the answer is yes. That Frank, the answer is this. Frank can change his will, which now says everything goes to Mary, to say, when I die, I want everything to go in a trust, a testamentary trust, because it's part of my will, for the benefit of Mary. And I'm going to name the kids, one of the, or all of them or whatever, as the trustees. And as long as the assets at the time Frank dies are in Frank's name, so that they've been transferred to him, it can be the day before he dies, right? As long as they're in his name at the time he dies, the day after his death, all of those assets are safe. Mary can go to the nursing home, or maybe she's already there, but Mary can go to the nursing home at any time, qualify for MassHealth right away, or she can qualify for this home program to keep her out of the nursing home called the Frail Elder Waiver. None of these assets will be counted. The trustees can use this money basically to supplement her care, right? Because if you're in a nursing home and you're on MassHealth, all of your income is going to the nursing home and then MassHealth is paying the rest. Remember I had mentioned that. So there's really nothing to live on. So this way, Frank can make sure that Mary is going to have all kinds of extra money because MassHealth's going to pay the nursing home bill. So if Mary needs a better wheelchair or better furniture or a set of headphones and a flat screen TV so that she can be watching movies and supposed to listening to her neighbor's TV, right? What all the other noise in the room, right? There's all kinds of money to do that. And following Mary's death, Frank can say the kids get all the rest of the money. There's no lien on any of this money. So in this case, Frank and Mary would be well advised if they don't know who might go to a nursing home first, but they're both 85, to get wills in place having these testamentary trust provisions and have both of them do it because they're not sure who might go to the nursing home or who might die first. And then if one of them gets sick, if one of them gets cancer, if one of them has a stroke, we just have to make sure that any assets that the other one wants to protect, they shift into the name of the person who's sick so that upon that person's death, everything goes into the testamentary trust for the benefit of the other one. That is a testamentary trust. So the wills with the testamentary trust, of course, can be changed, therefore, at any time by Frank and Mary while they're alive. When Frank dies, though, his trust, which is within the will, a testamentary trust, becomes irrevocable and unamendable. Irrevocable because he's dead, so we can't revoke it. And unamendable because you can't change a will after you're dead, right? So it's an irrevocable, unamendable trust. Now, suppose they hadn't done any of that, and now it's just Mary. And Mary's at this point saying, oh, I got all these assets, and I want to try to protect them for the benefit of my kids. This happens to me, I got to say, once a month that I talk to somebody, this has happened. It's a widow or a widower. Somebody just died, and they say, come in with one of their kids, typically the designated daughter. Everybody has like one designated daughter. They're never sons, right? They're very seldom sons. And, you know, I really want to protect everything. And I'll tell them, I say, well, you know, you should have talked to me a month ago. We could have taken care of all this. Everything would have been saved. We could have transferred it all to your husband before he died. But they didn't. So now what Mary is stuck with, if she wants to protect assets, is she has to get rid of them. She has to lose control of them and wait 5 years. That's the famous 5-year look-back period. She could do it in a couple of ways. She could simply give them away. She could give away the house and all of the cash and everything else to one of her kids. But of course, there were some disadvantages to that. We talked about those, right? Or she could basically do the same thing. transfer the assets to an irrevocable trust, right? An unamendable trust. And she's not one of the beneficiaries. And she's not the trustee. And one of the kids is the trustee. You name the kid or one of the kids as the trustees. Typically in these cases, you would also name the children as possible beneficiaries, so that at any time, if Mary asked the trustees and the trustees were in a good mood, right? I always say that's why you call them trusts. You know, you got to trust the trustee if you're setting up a trust. The kids, as one of the trustee, could basically make a distribution of some of these assets to the brothers and sisters, who could turn around and give it back to the parent. But the parent cannot have the legal right to make that happen. Otherwise, it's not. It may be an irrevocable and unamendable trust, but if the parent has the right to do that under the terms of the trust, it's not going to protect the asset for MassHealth purposes. So, one more case. So what if Frank and Mary want to, yes, that's right. So what if Frank and Mary, instead of having that $800,000, have the $1,000,002? And so they want to try to protect the assets for MassHealth purposes, but they also want to get rid of the estate tax. And the answer is, you can do both of those at the same time. And the way that you do it is that you make sure that the testamentary trust that they each have say that within the testamentary trust that a part of the assets, like in this case, the house, if Frank died first, right, would be in trust for Mary's benefit and for the benefit of the kids. Under the scenario that I'd given you before, he was going to put that money in trust, but everything else was simply going to go to Mary. Well, that doesn't work, though, for MassHealth purposes, because if he leaves the $800,000 to Mary, then Mary's going to have to spend it down for nursing home purposes. But he could instead say, regarding that $800,000, he's going to create a second trust within his will. So the will would contain basically two testamentary trusts, one holding the house, one holding everything else. The thing about that everything else trust, though, remember earlier on I said the nice thing about these tax avoidance trusts is that the surviving spouse can be the trustee, so that they're in control of the money. Well, you can't do that and protect it from MassHealth, because if you're in control of the money, MassHealth counts it. So they need to name the kids as the trustees, right? Finally, regarding that trust, they would have to specify that the income, not the principal of that $800,000, if it's for Mary's benefit, would have to get distributed to the nursing home. Right? So following Mary's qualifying for MassHealth, her income would include her pension and any income coming from this trust. But we could save the $800,000. So there is a way, using trusts, to not only minimize your estate tax, but also protect the assets if one dies and the other one needs nursing home care. To summarize, there are three kinds of problems that may have trust as a solution: probate avoidance, estate tax minimization, asset protection for nursing home purposes, right? If you have any of those problems, then a trust may be your correct solution. It may be one of the solutions. There may be others, right? But the main thing to remember is there isn't one size trust that fits all, right? Depends on your problem. And I'll give you the most common occurrence of the wrong trust. Regularly, I have folks who come in because their parents, or they, when they were younger, when they were 65 and weren't worried about nursing homes, wanted to avoid probate. And so they did a revocable and amendable trust. They put their house into the trust, maybe put some other money into trust. And then they put it away, right? Right? Because you never want to think about that again. You never want to talk to the lawyer again. You don't want to pay him any more money, you know? You don't want to think about it. So now it's 20 years later, and somebody's got Alzheimer's, right? And folks come in to see me. And they say, we're pretty sure we're okay because the house is in trust. So we think the house is fine. And they give me the trust, and it's one of those trusts. It's a revocable and amendable trust. And because it's revocable and amendable, it's still under the control of the old people, which means it's still their asset. If it's revocable and amendable, if they have control over it for MassHealth purposes, it counts. Which means if I'm dealing with a widow in that situation, she's going to have a problem, right? Because the only way she can protect that house is by transferring it out of her name and waiting 5 years. And she hasn't got 5 years. That's why she came in. It's because somebody's got Alzheimer's, right? So you want to get this. You want to know why you're doing this stuff. And when clients do these documents, and then they'll say, well, so, you know, when should we call you? And I'll say, when your situation changes, but maybe every few years, because you may not know that your situation changed, right? So call me. Just call. Talk about what's happening in your life, and we'll see whether maybe your situation has changed and therefore your goals have changed. So if you just thought this was fascinating but I was talking too fast, you can watch it again on Martha's Vineyard on the cable station. And thanks for Tom for recording, and thank you very much to Martha's Vineyard Cable for playing these shows over. Frank and Mary have their own YouTube channel, Elder Law Frank and Mary. You can go see this or any one of the shows that we do by watching this show. And remember this, the goal of life, once you get to be our age, is peace of mind. You know, I always say that, you know, once you get to be a certain age, like fame and fortune, you know, that's history. The goal is to sleep well at night. So the goal is to sleep well at night. So if this helps you, I'm glad it does. Any questions? Any questions? We covered a lot of stuff. Yes, ma'am.
Just real quick, because I don't want to take up a lot of time. Can you give us like a one-liner of the definition of a nominee trust and a Cupert trust?
A nominee trust and a Cupert. I'll talk about both of those. First, nominee trust. The nominee trust is today an irrelevance. It was designed, the purpose of it, this is a classic case of a nominee trust was designed to solve a particular problem. Until about 10 years ago. If I transferred my house to you as the trustee of the trust, but the trust itself is not on record, right? Legally, you simply became the owner of the house. The trust didn't exist, right? Which was unfortunate because a lot of times you wouldn't want to put the trust on record, not the one that says, oh, it goes to my spouse and then it gets liquidated and my kids, because you don't want that to be public, because this gets recorded in the registry of deeds. Right? And that was the problem. The solution was that you would do two trusts, right? The first one would have all these rules in it, and say it would be called the Bergeron Family Trust. And it'd describe who gets the kids and blah, 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 right? The second one would be a so-called nominee trust. And the nominee trust would name a trustee, one of the parents, one of the kids, it was irrelevant, right? But it would say right in the trust, the trustee, it has no other power except to do whatever the beneficiary says. And the beneficiary is listed in a schedule of beneficiaries which isn't recorded. And the beneficiary in that case would be the family trust, the trustee of the family trust. So it was a way to use this trust device, whether for revocable or irrevocable or whatever trust, without having to put your family information on record. Then came a statutory change. Finally, Massachusetts woke up to the fact that in most states, the trust doesn't have to be recorded. Instead, the rest of the world doesn't need to know all that other stuff about who the beneficiary is, but the rest of the world needs to know, if I'm a bank and you want to borrow money from me and I'm taking a mortgage, I don't care who the beneficiaries are, I just want to know you can sign the mortgage. You have the legal power to sign. So there's now, instead of recording the trust, you can record this trust certificate, which says this trust is in existence, and here are the trustees, and here's how the trust can get amended, right? So that any buyer or mortgagee can be sure the right guy is signing, right? And the trustee has the power to sign mortgages and deeds, right? And as long as that certificate is on record, you don't need to record the trust. And because of that, the nominee trust has become irrelevant. Some lawyers, some old guys like me that used to use them, still use them. I left those behind. Cuperts. I'm going to do a couple minutes on Cuperts. I'm going to talk a lot more about these at the next presentation. This is really important. A Cupert. So in the old days, before like about 2000, people were much more worried about the federal estate tax, as opposed to now, with the minimum federal, the minimum size estate subject to federal estate taxes, a little over $5.4 million. And if you're married and your spouse dies and doesn't use any of his exemption, which typically he or she wouldn't if they're giving everything to the spouse, right? Then you get your spouse's exemption too. So when you die, you get $10.8 million worth of exemption. So you can see that's become pretty irrelevant. So the federal estate taxes have become irrelevant to most people. Before, though, when the federal estate tax minimum was $1 million, and that wasn't that long ago, and when there wasn't any of this portability, right, this was very relevant to people because the federal estate tax rate, as opposed to the initial marginal rate in Massachusetts, which is like 6%, the federal rate, I think, started at like 38% or some huge number, right? So people were very interested in dealing with how to make sure that there was no estate tax on their house, or that the house wasn't included in their estate for federal estate tax purposes because the rates were so high. And typically the best way to get to do that was to get rid of the house, to cause the house to not be owned by you at the time of your death for estate tax purposes. And the way you did that was by creating something called a Qualified Personal Residence Trust, QPRT, always called QPRTs. And what you did when you created one of these trusts is you created a trust, and there was a trustee of this trust, typically for the benefit of your kids, and the kids were named as the beneficiaries. And then you deeded over a period of time your interest in your property to this QPRT, so that at the end of the day, after a number of years, the trustees of the QPRT ended up owning the house. Now, you made these gifts to your kids of the QPRT annually and always in amounts that were less than this federal amount that you can give away every year and not have it count for anything. And right now it's $14,000 a year. So if there were two parents giving to three kids, you could give 14 times 5. I won't go through the math. But that was the concept, right, that you were kind of giving away the house, and then you were leasing the house from the trust, right? And then, and over time, you had to verify that you were paying the necessary rent to the thing, all this thing. But that was the game. The goal was to get the house so that it wasn't part of your estate, right? A goal which has become totally irrelevant, practically totally irrelevant, because most estates aren't subject to federal estate tax. So now I'll give you a live example from a family on the other island, right? Where I was, and we're now unwinding one of these coupons. So these folks have this wonderful house, right? Their backs, it's on the water. And this guy's, I think it's his grandfather, bought this land on the water in the 1940s for $50,000. And when he died, when he and the grandmother died at like in the 50s or 60s, right? They left the land to their three kids. They divided the land into three pieces. Each piece has got about a couple of acres, right? And then those folks did a QPRT because they wanted to make sure that when they died, this house was not these properties were not going to get subject to estate taxation. So my guy's father owned one of these three. My father and mother owned one of these three properties and did the QPRT. And died, and so these folks call me because they're very excited because when the second parent died, there was no Massachusetts estate tax, which would have been $100,000 or something. And so they wanted to know if they should do a QPRT themselves, so as to make sure that this property would stay out of the estate tax system. So this property is now worth $3.4 million, right? Their tax basis in this property, because their parents had already distributed the property to them through this QPRT, right? When you make a gift to someone of appreciated property that's gone up in value from how much you paid for it, you also give them your tax basis. When I sell a piece of property, I have to pay a capital gains tax on the difference between the sales price and my basis in the property, right? If I inherit a piece of property, so it goes through my estate, while it's subject to estate tax, the basis jumps to the day-to-death value. So in this particular case, these people have a house. How much did I say? Was it 3.4. Their tax basis in this property is $500,000 because the property wasn't included in the parents' estate for estate tax purposes, and therefore the basis never jumped. So they own their parents' basis. They want to sell the house, because they got a child that lives in California, they want to move to California. They're going to pay a capital gains tax on the difference between $3.4 million, $3.4 or $3.2, and $500,000. right? So that's a tax on a, that's about 25% of about $3 million, or about $750,000 is going to be their capital gains tax. What they saved was $120,000 in estate tax. They made a mistake, right? They made a mistake. So what we're trying to do now, right, is what I told, they said, oh, we want to, I said, no, you don't want to sell this property, right? Don't sell this property. Don't do a Q-Bert, right? Because we want to make sure that this property is going to be part of their estate for estate tax purposes when they die, which means they're going to pay an estate tax on that kind of value, or of $200,000 or $300,000. But they're probably going to end up saving about $1 million for their kids, because they know that their kids are not going to be able to keep this property, right? Because they just, they don't have, there isn't enough money in the estate, right? So Q-Berts are a real problem, right? And we're going to talk about that more. I'm going to talk about that more at the next seminar, because we're going to be kind of talking about how you compare estate tax issues versus income tax issues, right? Among other things. Okay? That was a long answer, but I thought that was kind of important, because it's also kind of a preface to what's coming. It's a very important issue here, and you can imagine on the other island. Wicked. Wicked. Yes, sir?
Is your nickname Donald Trump?
I'm just smart. I'm just smart. I'm so smart I lost $1 billion, and now I don't have to pay any taxes. What a smart guy. That's like, people are always telling me that. Should I not sell my property? Because I'm going to have to pay tax. I say, well, you know, you sell your property, you make 75 cents. I mean, you're going to pay a capital gains tax of 25, but you're making money. You know. So anyway, that's a whole other. Other two more questions, and then I'm on the next boat, so I got to.
I have a quick question.
Yes,
ma'am. If you still have a small mortgage on your house, can you put it into a trust?
Technically, you are supposed to get the permission of the bank to do that, because there's going to be a provision in your mortgage that says that you can't convey out an interest in the property. It has been my experience, A, that banks, if asked, will typically grant that. They don't care. They still get their mortgage. And B, if you don't tell the bank, nobody cares, right? Nobody ever checks, right? You didn't kind of hear that.
Yeah.
Right. Yes, sir, and then you, ma'am. Yes, sir.
My understanding, my limited knowledge of the irrevocable trust to shield your assets,
yeah,
from has been challenged recently by MassHealth, and it's not the fail-safe solution that I always understood it to be. Would you comment on that?
Well, that's some of the stuff that we were talking about, right? The mere fact that it's called an irrevocable trust, right, without more, it doesn't mean that the assets that went into the irrevocable trust are safe. It has to not have certain kinds of provisions in it. One of the things that's being challenged, and actually one of the lawyers in our office is taking this up to the appeals court, is this whole issue of an irrevocable trust in which the house resides, and in which the people who put the property in trust are allowed to continue to live there, right? And the question is whether that's really whether they really put the property in trust, because what is a house? A house is the ability to live there. So there are several issues like that, right? So I think it depends on what the trust says.
Presumably you align your cash assets so that they're annuitized, if you will. And the goal is to shield the property, your home, from liens. But is that still a viable way of...
Is the irrevocable? Absolutely. As a matter of fact, the trust that I described to you that Mary could use, the trust that in which you transfer the house into the irrevocable trust. In that case, typically Mary would keep a life estate, but you put some cash in there too, and you say, right in the trust, that the trustees, or the kids, have the right to distribute money to themselves, even though the kids at that point can then turn around and give it back to you. Now, to some people, that sounds all like a scam, doesn't it? Or kind of a sham transaction. And MassHealth was taking the position that was a sham transaction, and in the last few years, there were a couple of superior courts that had backed up MassHealth. But then finally a case went up on appeal. And actually, this wonderful lawyer named Lisa Neely, who just moved, as it happens, to Myrick O'Connell, is a very confident person, won that case, right? She took it to the appeals court and won. So that trust with exactly those provisions was determined to be legitimate and the assets in them to be non-countable. I'm going to take one more question, though, and then I got to go. Yes, ma'am.
Was there some attempt through the legislature to increase the amount of time beyond 5 years to 11?
Is there an attempt in the legislature to increase the look-back period?
Look back.
No. Every year, people tell me that. Hasn't happened. It has happened in some states. The federal government, the federal law allows states to make the look-back period as long as 10 years. If I recall correctly, in Connecticut, it's 7. This varies by state.
Oh, okay.
But there's nothing, there's been no change and no effort to change that in Massachusetts. Okay? This is Massachusetts. You know, you got to love us. Yes, sir. I shouldn't do that. I should. Yeah, last question. Yes.
You had trust in bills drawn up in a different state.
Yep.
Moved to Massachusetts, and now you have assets in Massachusetts. Can you just put them, your new assets here in Massachusetts, into that trust on your own, or do you have to draw up a whole new trust and an entirely new will?
Question is, you had assets in a trust which was a foreign trust for Massachusetts purposes, which were drawn up in another state. And is that same trust going to work as to assets that are now new assets that are shifted in, or as to the old assets now that you're in Massachusetts? The answer is you got to look at the trust, because that question is a matter of Massachusetts law. Each state gets to decide to make its own rules regarding which trusts they're going to say are going to be legitimate here. Just like when we're doing trusts, because I often have folks that have got property in Florida also, right? And so I'll do a trust. Will be transferring property in, but they only want to do one trust so that when they end up, if they're trying to avoid probate, they ideally have one trust that avoids all the probate. But we always have a Florida lawyer check it, because there's some magic language that needs to be included in our trust in order to make sure that the Florida property is going to be okay.
The trust not registered anyways, trust are private documents, correct?
Trusts are private documents, but if you're if it's real estate, and your mortgagee bank or your buyer is wondering whether or not somebody has the power to transfer a piece of property, they're going to be reading it and they're going to be wondering about the local law. So you want to have it checked. That's all. Thank you very much. I really appreciate you coming. See you next time. Thank you.
I know about 7:15.
Hey, how you doing?
Does anybody know if the vote is 7:15 or 7:30?